Okay. All right. So again, another welcome. We're so glad and actually very impressed to have so many of you here at, 9 o'clock on a Saturday morning right after school has ended for the year. So thank you for being here. We know that many of you might be pretty new to PTA, and also that many of you who are new to PTA might just know it as the parent group at your school and not necessarily anything more than that. It might just be sort of synonymous with that idea of a parent group. And so this section is to orient you a little bit to what the PTA is, what the structure of it is, the basics, why it was founded, and the benefits of being part of the PTA. Okay, so we'll start here. And what is the PTA? PTA is the oldest and largest advocacy association in America. PTA is comprised of millions of parents and teachers and grandparents, caregivers, foster parents, and other caring adults who have this commitment to improve the education, the health, and the safety of all children. And we've been doing it for more than 125 years. And you'll see this tagline often with the PTA, every child, one voice. So we are trying to speak together as an organization with one voice, unified for every child. The PTA was founded by some pretty powerhouse women who are shown here on the left, who are greatly concerned about the nation's children when they founded it. The United States was feeling this enormous impact of the Industrial Revolution, and there was a really big wave of immigration flowing into the country. Children were working in factories and in mines and in the streets of the cities, and many of them could not attend school or even have enough food to eat. And so they wondered what they could do. Alice McClellan Birney and Phoebe Apperson Hurst did extensive grassroots organizing to bring their ideas to others, and they made all of this happen. A few years later, some very similar concerns caused some folks in California to take the same kind of action, and they joined the national group in 1902. The National Congress of Colored Parents and Teachers was formed by Selina Sloan Butler in 1926 to address students' needs at the still sanctioned segregated schools after founding her own school's PTA and the Georgia State PTA. So this group merged together with the National PTA in 1970 in recognition that regardless of race, color, or condition, all of us need to recognize that the Republic's greatest work is to save the children. So today, the issues that affect our children extend beyond their individual schools, and so PTAs provide parents with the forum and lots of tools to collectively influence the decisions that affect children not only in their schools, but also throughout their districts, within their states, and across the nation. So this is a unique mission to PTA. And many of the benefits our children receive today, such as universal kindergarten, the National School Lunch Program, and also the juvenile justice system, were all accomplished as a result of the PTA mission. PTA is an independent nonprofit membership organization. So here's something else that's unique. The members are making the decision about everything together. The members are the primary authority on the budget, the programs, electing officers, and more. So you all as officers are not making those decisions on your own. The executive board is directed by the work of the association and what they approve. The PTA is also independent from the school and the district, but we do partner and support, of course. That's essential if we want to get anything done. We do need to partner, but it is independent. So the school district, the school can't make the PTA do anything. It is an independent organization. Okay. As a 501c3 nonprofit organization, each of your PTAs are this. This means that you have been authorized by the IRS as a tax-exempt charitable organization. And charitable purposes are purposes that are in the public interest, but those are specified specifically in your PTA bylaws. If you've had a look at those, or you'll get to look at those very soon, you'll see what those purposes are. they're very related to education and child safety and things like that. There is also part of the requirements for 501c3s, you have to remain this public charity and not be a private foundation. You have to obtain at least a third of your donated revenue from fairly broad base of public support. So that's individuals, companies, other public charities, which none of our PTAs have any issue doing, but that is a requirement of a 501c3. Donations to our PTAs, because they are public charities, can be tax deductible to the individual donor. And then public charities also have to have a governing body that is mostly made up of independent, unrelated individuals. So exactly what we have in our PTA boards. Also, no part of the activities or the earnings. So the funds that you raise in your PTA cannot unfairly benefit any person, like an officer on your board or a private individual. So that money isn't going to them. We don't give gifts to people as PTAs, not to teachers, not to individual people who we think are amazing. That's not what the PTA funds are for. There are also restrictions for 501c3s about lobbying, and that it is just that it needs to be insubstantial. So you wouldn't spend the majority of your resources lobbying, specifically lobbying, for instance, in Sacramento, which needs to be insubstantial. And then the other thing you'll see here on the right is that the PTA is non-commercial, non-sectarian, and non-partisan. Non-commercial means that we don't promote the goods or services of any other organization. So we don't say, go buy things at this particular store because we like them. You can let people know that there are restaurants or stores who are giving benefits to PTA members, but you can't say you should go support only this one over other ones. That's something you can't do because we're non-commercial. Non-sectarian means that we welcome into membership people representing a diversity of cultures, ethnic backgrounds, and political and religious beliefs. We aren't exclusive to any one of those. And then nonpartisan means that we do not support any candidates for office or any political party, even if it's a nonpartisan office like school board. We do, however, take positions on issues. So that is something that you will see the PTA often doing. It's a big part of our work as an advocacy organization. So who can be a member of your PTA? Anyone, really. So you can reach out and ask people to join who are parents and caregivers, grandparents, any family member, students can be also members of the PTA, educators, administrators, other staff at your school, community members and neighbors. We have some PTAs who have had a large part of their PTA has been members of the community as opposed to someone who has a direct relationship within the school as a staff member or a family member. So really anyone is welcome to be a part of the PTA as long as they care about our mission and want to help us move it forward. So let me share a little bit with you about the purposes of the PTA and our mission. So the PTA's mission is to make every child's potential a reality by engaging and empowering families and communities to advocate for all children. The California PTA's mission, if you even zoom in, that was the national one. The California PTA's mission is to positively impact the lives of all children and families. And then here in the Second District PTA, we have written a mission, and that is to advocate for, cultivate, and empower individual units, that's you, in San Francisco to improve the education, health, and well-being of children and families. And then for all of you at the unit level, which again is what we call you as the individual PTAs at schools around the city, you'll see this in your bylaws too, but the purposes of your PTA at your school are in common with the purposes of the National and California State PTA. And that is you want to promote the welfare of children and youth in home, school, places of worship, and throughout the community, to raise the standards of home life, to advocate for laws that further the education, physical and mental health, welfare and safety of children and youth, to promote the collaboration and engagement of families and educators in the education of children and youth, to engage the public in united efforts to secure the physical, mental, emotional, spiritual, and social well-being. You hear that a lot of all the children and youth. So we want to advocate for laws, promote collaboration and engagement of families and educators in doing all that, and then also engaging the public in united efforts to do all that. And then we also want to advocate for fiscal responsibility regarding public tax dollars and public education funding. So you always hear about how public schools are not adequately funded around the nation, especially here in California. It's getting a little better than it was, say, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, but it is still one of our priorities to make sure that it is funded so that the needs of our students are met while they're in our schools. Okay, this is a great set of PTA values. You can find this on the National PTA website, but I love those. And I feel like these resonate with me so much, and certainly the work that we try to lead in the Second District. And that is collaboration. We want to work in partnership with a wide array of individuals and organizations to broaden and enhance our ability to serve and advocate. right? So partnership is really essential. We cannot go this alone. Commitment, we're dedicated to children's educational success, health, and well-being through strong family and community engagement while remaining accountable to the principles upon which our association was founded. So make sure we're staying anchored in that, right? We don't find some other idea we think is so great, but it's different from that. We stay committed to those foundational principles to support our children and youth. And this third one is diversity. And that is that we acknowledge the potential of everyone without regard, including but not limited to age, culture, economic status, educational background, ethnicity, gender, geographic location, legal status, marital status, mental ability, national origin, organizational position, parental status, physical ability, political philosophy, race, religion, sexual orientation, and work experience. So that's a huge list, and that doesn't even describe all the different identities folks have, but we acknowledge the potential of everyone that has these kinds of identities and more. We also respect, and so we value the individual contributions of members, employees, volunteers, and partners as we work collaboratively to achieve our association's goals. So we respect each other and what we each have to offer as we come to this work together. And then accountability means that we all, employees, members, volunteers, partners, all have a shared responsibility to align our efforts towards the achievement of our association's strategic initiatives. This is a list of some of the priorities that the PTA has had over the years. You'll see the dates here. These are resolutions that have been passed by the state membership in California of the kinds of priorities that we have. You'll see things around here around teacher prep, juvenile justice reform, safety. You'll see, and that's related to like transportation and gun safety, playground equipment, things like that. You'll see all those here. And then there's a few that are not listed here. You'll hear more about these as you move through your term next year. There are some current priorities with the state PTA around literacy is a big one. Here in Second District PTA, we've been also focusing a lot on literacy and also suspension and reducing that and making sure that we're supporting attendance in schools so that students can receive the education and support they need to be successful. So you'll see, and arts education has always been a big focus of the PTA. And so you can find more about current priorities. These are all priorities because they've all been designated as priorities by our members. And then there are some priorities that get a little bit more attention as in whatever current state we're in. And you can find information about that on the California PTA website. Okay, who the PTA serves. These are numbers from the national level, just to give you an idea of how big the PTA is. So as I mentioned, we're the oldest and largest child advocacy organization. There's more than 24,000 local PTAs, nearly 4 million members. And I have to tell you that California is a huge chunk of that. We have, I don't know, maybe the folks who went to convention heard what the latest number is, but I'm thinking it's probably 700,000 or 800,000 members across the state. I don't know if they know or want to jump in. Does Linda or Melissa, do you know? It's okay if you don't.
I don't know, but I can find it.
And I'll post it in the chat. She can post it in the chat. We have had, it's definitely a large portion. So California, we're a big state, but we have definitely a large number of those members. So we have a really robust California PTA. And so part of this nationwide network, we have, as parents, we have a voice in decisions that impact children in their schools and all of these other levels of our government and our schools. So there are more than 16.5 million students served through PTAs, by PTAs in the US, Washington, DC, the Virgin Islands, Puerto Rico, and the Department of Defense schools in Europe. 55% of PTAs throughout the country serve Title I schools. So that is schools who are serving large percentages of students who qualify for free and reduced price meals. Then 59% of the students PTAs serve are students of color throughout the country. 71% of PTAs serve elementary schools. And then they award more than $400,000 in grants to PTAs and schools for program efforts. And 69% of dues that are received for PTAs are spent on programs specifically. There's of course lots more to do, but the specific programs that are meant to benefit, there's a large part of the dues are spent in that way. Okay. Now, a little bit more of this, the value proposition of PTA. PTA is here to help create connections between our families and all of the folks who work at our schools to support our students and our community members who can help advance these missions related, the mission related to our children. The PTA supports your child. That's the kind of anchor throughout our work. And the PTA also amplifies your voice. So when all of us are working together towards a specific focus, that helps the things that each of us care about have a greater weight. When we can go and advocate to legislators for certain positions or with certain positions, knowing that they have hundreds or thousands of PTA members behind that is really, it makes it a really strong message. The other thing I wanted to share with you, something we've been spending a lot of time over the last couple of years in the district PTA, is a commitment to anti-racism. And this is a statement that I pulled directly from our website. You're welcome to go to that sfpta.org to learn more about how we've been trying to do this. But we're committed to anti-racism, which we have defined here as the conscious and active effort to identify, challenge, and correct racial inequities in the systems and institutions within our schools and community. We will support anti-racist policies, programs, and practices for our children's education and well-being, and build strong and inclusive school communities. We strive to uncover unconscious biases and practice anti-racism as individuals and as PTA representatives. We challenge ourselves to persist through the discomfort necessary for growth and learning. We commit to deepen our listening and our examination of racism and oppression, to develop a strong understanding of how our personal experience and feelings fit into a larger picture. Okay, now I'm going to tell you a little bit about our PTA structure. So, how many of you knew before this presentation that PTA is part of a national organization? When I first was joining the PTA, and just not even just as a member, like when I was looking at becoming an officer in our elementary school, I had no idea that the PTA was a national organization. So the national PTA is comprised of 54 state congresses and more than 20,000 local units in all 50 states, the District of Columbia, the U.S. Virgin Islands, Puerto Rico, and the Department of Defense schools in Europe that I mentioned a minute ago. And state PTAs, you can see in this chart, are the liaison between the local and the national PTA, helping each to function effectively and to support and sustain each other. The California state PTA is broken into 27 geographical districts. Those are not the same as school districts. There's like 1,000 school districts in the state. So the PTA districts are, they're just a different setup. We're a little unique here in Second District because we are a county and a school district and a PTA district, but that's not common throughout the rest of the state. Most other districts, PTA districts, also have something called councils, which is just in between a district and a unit. Like some of our districts have hundreds of units in them. And so they have a council that sort of is in charge of like a good body of units. And so they'll just have several councils. So it's just an in-between level. We don't have any councils here in Second District. These are, all of you are out of council. So you might see that language on your bylaws that you're out of council. So we don't have that. I'm also using PTA and PTSA interchangeably. Most of the time you'll see a PTSA, which is Parent Teacher Student Association at secondary schools, like middle and high schools. They don't have to be. You could call your elementary school a PTSA if you want to have students actively involved in your PTA, but they, you know, you don't have to do that. We have 62 unit PTAs, that's you, the school site, in Second District, soon to be 64. We have a couple in process right now in the stages of being chartered. The PTAs at this local level are valuable assets to your communities because you are the ones who are working directly with parents and caregivers and students and the staff. You are providing providing informational resources, events, and activities. And so this is a really important level. And this is the level that you represent and why you're here today. PTA units are organized and chartered according to some rules and regulations outlined in the California State PTA bylaws. And probably most of you are not familiar with that process because your PTA has been in place for quite a long time. Some PTAs in our district have been around for 100 years. So, and we've been around obviously over 100 years. If we've got some of you who are longer than 100 years, but we, so you may not be as familiar with what that process is like. You are self-governing organizations. You have your independent status as a 501c3 organization, and you have your own board, which many of you are part of your boards, who govern your organization and as guided by your members. However, each of you as individual units are required to observe policies of California State PTA and the National PTA because you are a PTA. By being a PTA, that obligates you to be part of that. So, let's move on to, I just wanted to show you, if you're curious, a list of all of the schools who have PTAs here in SFUSD that are part of Second District. I'll leave this up on the screen for a second for you to take a look. You should see your own PTA here. And then I wanted to give you a few basics. So every PTA, to stay in good standing, has to have at least 15 members. We hope you have many more because there's so many more people than that in your schools, but you must have at least 15 members. The membership, minimum membership dues are $475 per person. This amount is passed along to the district, state, and national PTAs. It gets divided up between these three groups, and they use that those funds to pay for, you know, like producing the website and all the resources that we all go to all the time when we have questions. And there, the California PTA, for instance, has a few staff members who help because we have so many units, PTAs in the state. They have some people on staff who can help with tax filings, who help with all of the logistical paperwork, data kind of stuff. We need folks to help with that who are not just volunteer and filling this in around the rest of their lives, people who are doing it full time. And so that also helps to pay for that. Each PTA can set the amount for its membership dues in their bylaws. A lot of our PTAs in San Francisco average around $10 a person. So that means that $475 would go up to the other levels of the PTA, and that $525 would stay with your PTA. You're also required to have president, treasurer, and secretary. Those are required officers, and those are actually required by the law, not us as a PTA specifically. Those are required by law. And if you do not have those, then you need to find replacements as soon as you can. We know we're in a bit of a transition period. Some people were able to elect all of those before the end of the year. If you didn't have a chance to, if you have a plan, do it as soon as you get back to school. Or if you need some support, please contact us and we'll help you to figure out how to do that. If you go on too long without having those roles, you're just not able to properly do the business of your organization. The policies that we have around all of this are in existence to protect the reputation and integrity of your organization. So you become at risk to be closed, and you don't want to do that. Your PTA is so valuable to your community for a lot of different reasons. But, you know, sometimes life happens, holes exist. And so just be in touch with us and we'll help you figure it out if you haven't, if you don't have that in place. And I did want to mention also that the principal has an automatic voting seat on your board, and, or they can designate a different administrator. And then of course you can have different officers too, but those are the ones we'll focus on for requirements. Okay, some benefits of PTA. As I mentioned, advocacy is sort of the centerpiece of what we do. And this is the collective working together, this that tagline I mentioned, every child, one voice. This is actually why I got involved with the PTA. It's what drew me in to begin with when my kids got really, when they were younger and we were facing the recession back in 2008, the PTA started doing a lot of advocacy at the state level. That really drew me in. And then I started to organize some efforts here in San Francisco because we were also facing a huge, huge, huge budget cut in SFUSD. And so the idea that we could all work together for a larger impact was really attractive to me. So that's the thing that's been, that drew me in to begin. There's a lot more that has made me stay, but that is definitely the thing that drew me in to begin with. Here's a few other benefits to being part of a PTA is the information you get. We have a lot of resources and programs. Reflections is an art program that you can bring into your school. School Smarts is a program that you can bring in and have cohorts of parents go through or caregivers go through that help them learn how the school system works, the education system works, but it also has an art component to it. We have a lot of membership campaign ideas, STEM and literacy program ideas, and a lot more resources and programs you can find on the California PTA website. That's capta.org. There's a lot of updates and advice that you can get from the PTA. There's newsletters. The various levels of PTA have websites where you can find things. There's a magazine. There's a leader kit that you get when you're a brand new officer that just gives you a lot of guidance and updates. There are also benefits. If you are a member of a PTA, I don't know how often your PTA has promoted this, but if you click on this link, we'll share these slides later, you'll see a whole list of discounts you can get as a PTA member. I know in the past, I don't know if it right now you can do this, but there was a link you could get a discount on rental cars. There have been there have been discounts to get into different museums, things like that. So that's a good way to draw members in. And then also the PTA offers millions of dollars in grants. So we in the California PTA have outreach and translation grants. So if you're trying to provide interpretation services or translate written documents, you can get a grant to help pay for that if you don't have money in your PTA to do that. And if you're going to launch some programs related to any of these other areas below, like healthy lifestyles, arts and culture, parent education, you can apply for grants. These are all due in October. Just heads up. So think about that early in your year and write they're very short proposals to try to get that kind of those funds. There's also scholarships for parent education and for high school seniors, continuing education for staff, like teachers at your school as well. So those are scholarships and grants that are available to you if you apply. And again, those are due in October. You'll see that. We'll talk about that a little bit more later. So you also get guidance and support to run your PTA. We are here for you. You have a lot of leadership development opportunities. There's webinars, courses, like the national, state, and local. All of us have opportunities on our website. You can go and do it your own pace when you want. There's a lot of templates if you want to run membership campaigns or sample agendas, different things to help you not have to reinvent the wheel. There's a program called My PTEZ, where you list your officers and then we have their contact information. You get newsletters from us. It also helps with membership and submitting your reports. As you have a financial report, your budget, you can upload all of that there. And it's a great place that lives online to have continuity of information as you move in between boards, because you know when you're moving in and out of leadership every year or two, then it's nice to have all of that in one place. We also help you with your bylaws and structure to help you make sure your PTA is inclusive. When you have that structure, it also makes your PTA more predictable and transparent and helps you stay accountable to your members. You have conventions like Melissa and Linda were just mentioning that you can attend, conferences for emerging minority leaders, male mentors. There's a lot of different opportunities for you to connect with other people and to learn. And there's also affordable insurance, which is not a small thing. Insurance can be very expensive if you are your own standalone organization and not part of the PTA, but they get a bulk rate. And so we're able to have very, very affordable insurance for your PTA. So you're protected as you do the activities. You also get to network as part of the PTA. You're not an island. When you come to a training like this, you're getting to see lots of people from all kinds of other PTAs around the city and the district. We also have something we started during the pandemic called 411 Wednesdays that we have held them on Wednesday nights, not every Wednesday. It's depended on frequency and interest to how often those happen, but those are meant to help you not feel isolated and also to give you information to support your leadership and support your school. Different trainings. We have second district events and meetings. Like we do a Founders Day celebration every year, which is to recognize the founding of the PTA. We also have listservs that you will all get added to later this summer so that you can connect with people who are in your similar roles. So there's a president's listserv, so that all of the presidents can bounce ideas off of each other. And that can be very active. There's a financial officer listserv. If you have questions, if you're in charge of financial reports and different things like that. So those are also resources for you to network and connect with each other. And so the last question I would ask you here is, now that you know a little bit more about the PTA, is why you're here. You know, what draws you to this organization? Why did you agree to be an officer? Why did you even join your PTA? What do you get? What do you want to give in your service? And what do you want to get and learn over the next year? So that can be just an introspective question. Or if anybody wants to share out loud, please feel free to unmute yourself and let us know what draws you to this organization. And I'll just wait a minute. If nobody speaks up, then I'll just move on to questions.
Well, I'm joining. I'll speak up a little bit. Personally, I went to private school. My parents sort of really stretched them, so I can't afford to do that for my kids, and I want to do anything I can to sort of supplement public education, and want to do it, you know, for the whole school, make the system good. I was at we were at Rooftop before, where they have a very active, very generous parent cohort. So now we've moved to high school, and I want to try to recreate some of that goodness.
Wonderful. Thanks for sharing, Ted. Does anybody else want to share?
I'll share. This is Gina.
Yeah, please.
I'm at Marina Middle School, and I have another child at Washington High School. and I started out with elementary school, but a PTO. And I'll be honest and say that I joined because the principal told me to be on the board. And so I did. So don't never underestimate the power of the principal. Mm-hmm. Have them on your side. And so I did it just because I was told to. I stuck with it. And now I see on the PTA level just how impactful it can be for the parents and the families. So not only are we advocating for the kids, I feel like we're advocating and educating parents. So it's important for us to have a resource, because I see parents they come with me, they come to me for everything. And if we weren't there as a PTA, you know, they would, I think, be more lost. But I feel like we're still kind of lost in general coming out of the pandemic, but I find that it's really important to be a source of information for the families and parents.
Thank you for sharing, Gina. Before we move on to our next session, next section, are there any questions about what I shared? You'll get this slide deck that has all of the notes and, you know, everything later in the recording. But are there any questions, like clarifying questions, that folks have? Great. Either you were overwhelmed or I was very comprehensive. one last piece of advice I want to give you, Melissa started to say this also through the rest of these sessions, is this is going to be a lot of information today, and it may feel like information overload. It's okay. We have all these decks and recordings you'll get later. My advice to you is to grab a piece of paper now and just write down two or three things from each of these sections that stand out to you, that you want to remember, that resonated with you particularly. And just write down the two or three things. And other than that, just soak it in and don't try to remember every single thing. Just pull just a couple of things that really resonate with you to think about until you get all the links later. So, okay, great. I'm going to stop our recording here so we can